Hi, and welcome back to the second part of the Botvinnik series. First video, I looked at the games, the second round game in the Soviet Chess Championship from 1931, and today I'm going to look at round three. So the score so far for Botvinnik was one loss and one win. In round three, he was playing against the famous composer Kasparian, that is very mentioned in today. That his endgame studies is highly praised, and I must admit I haven't solved any of them and looked at any of them so far. But maybe I will give it a try sometime. But here it was also early in Kasparian's career, and he was not yet a national master, so he definitely had his best years to come. Botvinnik, he played black, and Kasparian played white. The game started with e4, and Botvinnik played the Sicilian defense. And here Kasparian played knight f3 and e6 by Botvinnik. And here Kasparian played what's called today the Kramnik variation, with this interesting move c4, and it tries to stop any push with the d pawn from black, so you might get some kind of locked structure in the center, or you can go down another path, like we will see here in this game. But when he played knight c6, and Kasparian played knight c3, and here, but when he played knight f6. d4, and here is challenging black's center or c pawn, and you can see might see that a move like d3 is a little bit passive, but it's playable. But I think black has an easier task with the coming out of this opening compared to the more straightforward d4. And here Botvinnik took, and knight takes d4, and now you can see that this knight is putting pressure on the e-pawn, therefore Botvinnik plays bishop to b4, putting a pin on this knight, and now this pawn is potentially up for grabs. For this reason, there's only one real alternative. It's knight takes c6, but it has also tried to play f3 or in queen to d3, but with the poor results. So knight takes c6, and here you can say you can either take with the d pawn or the b pawn, and taking with the d pawn leads to a queen exchange, and that might not be everybody's cup of tea. So you can also take here with b and go for pushing the d pawn. But in the game, Botvinnik wasn't afraid of going into an endgame, and Kasparian took, and Botvinnik recaptured, and now you can see that the threat is reactivated on the e-pawn. So now the knight is defended. And you can see if we take here, then this knight. Oh, sorry. Probably is no good. It could be something like this. So let's just go back. So here, Kasparian. Botvinnik played e5, and you can see that now this bishop has a diagonal to move on, and it can probably go to e3, putting pressure on this pawn. Kasparian castled long, and now you can see that the rook is a threat. So you can't really go for this capture now because of the check here. So this pawn can't really be taken. So therefore, Botvinnik played king e7, getting the king out of the way. And Kasparian played f3, protecting the e-pawn finally. And here, Botvinnik calmly played bishop to e6, developing the bishop off the back rank, and now the rooks are connected. So he's finished his development, and white is still to move his bishop off the back rank. Kasparian played bishop to e3, trying to open the diagonal, and for that reason he's a little bit behind in development because of the bishop and the rook. And here Botvinnik played knight d7, it wasn't really clear to me at first why he played this move, but after looking at it, it became clear that white has plans of playing a move like f4, putting pressure on this pawn, and it could be good to play this f6 move, protecting this central e-pawn. And now Kasparian probably blundered because he played the move a3, I think it's a blunder because now Botvinnik can give up the bishop for the knight and create two double pawns, this pawn is also isolated, so the pawn structure is permanently damaged, we'll see in the game how Botvinnik exploit this very very efficient and creates he also creates some other damages on white's pawn structure, and it's very decisive for the game, and he makes it look very easy actually. So I'm very impressed so far with how he plays. I must say he plays c5, stopping any advance on of the c pawns, and this is still looking at the c4 pawn. Now Kasparian played the f4 move I talked about before, and instead of playing the move f3 directly, where white maybe play f5 and forcing the bishop back, Botvinnik played the intermediate move bishop to g4, attacking the rook, and the rook steps up out of danger, and now Botvinnik played f6, so he just pushed this rook off the back rank, and now The rooks aren't connected, this bishop stands a little bit more active, and I think that's probably the idea behind this. And instead of you getting this locked this locked structure, and I think also I would prefer this compared to so Kasparian took on e5 and f6, and now Kasparian gave a check, and the now you can see that this knight may be in a little bit of trouble because of the rook. So the king has to stay and look out for it. And here after h3 the bishop comes back, and now rook to d6, putting pressure on the bishop. And I think it's very very calm play that Botvinnik plays king to f7, and I think it's normally you would be afraid, but because of the bishop and the rook that's still undeveloped, this isn't really any threat in for Black's position. So you can the Black and can untangle it in a very very nice manner. Kasparian played e2, finally developing the bishop, and here Botvinnik played knight f6, and now the pawn protects, and this bishop is doing a really nice job attacking this pawn and stopping any checks here. And Kasparian decides to take the knight due to the threat of taking on the e4. So here, after g takes f6, Kasparian plays bishop to g4, and that allows Botvinnik to create you can also you could maybe, I don't know, if you take here directly, then what will you play? And I think white is going to be okay in this position, because the rooks get into the position, and I think this is probably holdable for white. Instead of that, Botvinnik plays his rook over to protect the bishop. And after the doubling of the rooks, Botvinnik takes on g4, and now he has created a really horrible pawn structure for his opponent. And the threat of rook to d1 isn't really a threat anymore, because the rook can come up and play to e7 and defend. So from here on, Botvinnik just has to find a way to mop up the pawns, and he plays rook to g8, and now Kasparian puts pressure on the f6 pawn. No problem. Rook e6. Check back, and after this little maneuver, you could have a repetition, but Botvinnik could see that that the king can find safety behind the rook, so it's okay to give up this this pawn. So he takes on g4, and here hides the king, and now you can see that this is a really nice structure compared to these pawns. And when this pawn falls, the g pawn, this pawn can be a real nuisance for white. So after rook to f5, Botvinnik takes, and the king comes up, and Botvinnik plays over for against the g file, and now Kasparian takes on e5, and Botvinnik takes on g2, and now gives some checks and takes the rook. So now it's rook against rooks and pawns, and now it's just a question of our technique and this dangerous pawn. So you can see here it is no problem that the white rook can take these pawns as long as you can advance this h pawn. So Botvinnik goes forth and plays it up the board, and you can see that even this, if the rook comes and takes this pawn, that then the rook is in time, and these two weak pawns can't really do anything. I think it's a really good game by Botvinnik, exploiting the destroyed pawn structure of Kasparian, and just shows you that you really need to keep an eye on your pawn structure, because it can lead to a quick defeat, like in this game. Please, if you like the video, subscribe to the channel, and give it a like and a comment if you want to. Next game will be one more from the Soviet Chess Championship of 1931. So until next time, have a good time. Bye.